Kia ora, I'm Rangi. I grew up in the Te Uruwera National Park, Tūhoe country. I've got a couple of soft white boy bushmen, known as the Graft Boys, sons of a Te Uruwera deer hunter, to do the hard yards and show you all about our wild places. This is our story. The Graft Boys are heading south to Rakiura, the land of the glowing skies. They're looking for our national bird, the kiwi, or to be correct, the southern tokoeka. Fervo's Strait is one of the world's toughest patches of water. A couple of seasickness tablets for the Graft Boys makes their 1 hour journey a lot more easy. Mind you, I don't know what they're worried about. These modern boats sure beat the waka for journey time and comfort. Rakiura is remote but has all the Pākehā conveniences. There aren't many people here though, something like 400 of them, so it's kind of quiet. Kāpai. We're going bush bashing, my friends, but first up, Clyde's gonna pick the brains of this bloke, Philip Smith, who's a local expert on the kiwi.
There's a variety of food they eat in the bush. It's mainly invertebrates, millipedes, centipedes, slugs, snails, slaters. On the mainland, they eat lizards and frogs and that type of thing. Stewart Island, they eat freshwater crayfish out of the streams.
That sounds like the diet my whānau enjoyed 300 years ago.
A lot of people think that they only come out at night. The Stewart Island brown are diurnal, they come out day and night, you know.
Okay, we're in Half Moon Bay at the moment, but the water taxi will pick you up from Golden Bay, and he'll take you right up the top of Patterson's Inlet, into the southwest arm, and he'll take you right up into the river, right up to where the dock hut is here. And that's at Rakiahua.
Yes, we'll go and get the dinghy, get it set up, and we're away.
Veteran water taxi skipper Ken Geeson gets the boys out onto the water, pronto.
Yeah, I've been in here a few times. We're working out at over 2,500.
It's the sort of country you'd expect to have inhabited by crocodiles.
Clyde and Steve's father, Egon, and brother Paul are coming along on this trip. A smart move. Something's got to carry all this stuff.
How's it looking?
It looks all right for about 11 o'clock.
Good. Sweet. Yeah, great.
Have a good time.
Yes.
Yeah, and we hope your memory's all right.
No, I won't forget you. That's all right, because you haven't paid yet, see?
Yeah. Extraction time sorted and a removal truck needed. Typical Pākehā, so much gear for only a few days. If the water taxi doesn't turn up in a month, they'll still have too much stuff. Ah, the door's around this side, bro. The boys spend the rest of the day settling in, making their beds comfy, and doing much about nothing. Tomorrow, with any luck, they'll get their act together.
Well, it's our first morning here on the Rakiahua block on the far end of Patterson Inlet. Yesterday when we arrived, it was a gorgeous day, perfectly calm. Today we've got strong winds and I think we're in for a mixture of weather, probably some heavy rain coming, I'd say. Our objective here is to try and see kiwi during the daytime. Now, kiwi, of course, are a nocturnal bird. However, here on Stewart Island, for some strange reason, they do often come out in the daytime. And now we've got the still camera, so we're hoping to get some fantastic shots if we can. And the great thing about this area, you never quite know what lies in store, so we'll see how we get on.
The Department of Conservation estimates there are about 15,000 kiwi on this island, so if you want to see tokoeka, this is the best place to do it. However, their territory can span over 50 hectares.
We've just come across a few propoles in this area where they stick their beak in and they can actually sniff out tasty morsels from under the surface as their nostrils are right on the tip. And see, there, it's amazing just how deep they go. See, that's gone in about that far. So at least we know we're in a good area here. Now, of course, if you do happen to see a kiwi, never try and touch or handle the birds. And if you're using a camera, don't flash them or use any bright lights. And one other thing, if you are bending over in this grass, be careful of your eyes, I just about poked myself with the spear grass.
Ha! I know what that's like.
We left the hut probably an hour ago this morning, and she's a bit low-lying, scrubby and swampy down there, so we thought we'll cut off the track and come up the side where it gets into the bigger bush. And we've seen the odd kiwi track in the mud down there, so that's a good sign. But there's actually the odd deer through here as well, but predominantly whitetail. Not many though, very low numbers. We have actually seen a fresh mark or two going up here, and there's a bit of fresh droppings down here, so as you can see there. But we'll carry on up anyway.
There's both white-tail deer and red deer present on Rakiura. The whitetail were originally gifted to Aotearoa by President Roosevelt in the early 1900s. Good on them, eh? Much of the island's income is now made from visiting hunters. If you're looking for kiwi, you need to keep your senses sharp, we. Scan for any movement, colour, shape and sound. But it also pays to look in all directions, not only at the ground, because you never know what else could be lurking, like this little blob in the skylight. This bird is a ruru, or mopok in Pākehā talk. It's Aotearoa's only native owl. They're quite ferocious night hunters, and you can often see them watching you as the day's end approaches. If you're careful, you can get in close for a photo. See how those big eyes pick up the slightest movement? They can spot prey like moths, birds, lizards, and pretty much anything, right through to rats in really low light.
Sweet little guys, aren't they? The old moorbok. Just keep your eyes open as you're wandering through the bush, because they just tend to swoop in any little dark shadow that goes in front of you. It's often a moorbok.
The bird life here is choice. With everything from korimako to kaka, it's lucky the boys are searching the ground as well as the trees. It's hard enough to find a live tokoweka, let alone this.
We just found the most amazing thing. Now, we've been to Stewart Island several times over the last few years, and we've never found anything quite like this. It's the entire skeleton of our iconic bird, the kiwi. Now, we're actually going to remove it out of there, because nobody ever gets to see it down there, so we're going to take it and hand it into the local dock office and see if they want to put it on display or something like that. But I'll just be very careful down here, because the beak has got a few little roots around it. The last thing we want to do is snap anything off. Now look at that. That's just amazing, isn't it? It's one of the great things of Stewart Island in particular. You just never know what you're going to find. Now, goodness knows how old that is, because kiwis, of course, live a long time, you know, up to 30 years or even longer. So, goodness knows what it died of, probably old age. Everything dies eventually. But anyway, we'll put that down carefully and we'll gather up the whole skeleton.
What I'm going to do is I'm just going to pop in the coordinates of these kiwi bones so we know exactly where they are if we ever needed to reference it at the point again in the future. So we'll just go there, waypoint manager, change name, pop in here, kiwi bones. There, done.
Of course, what we should have is a sieve and find the little fine bones and sieve out the dirt.
If you do come across the remains of a protected species, the law says that you must hand them in and report all findings to the Department of Conservation or your local iwi. Coming up, the boys not only find kiwi, but they discover something very few Pākehā will see. It's day two of the Graph Boys' search for the elusive kiwi on the Rakiahua block on Rakiura.
Kiwi's just crawled in here. Gotta go very carefully because you can hear them rustling and making movement. So we'll sneak in, go careful. And hopefully you'll cross a little opening where we can get a few shots. Let's go.
It rained all night, so it's a bit slushy underfoot, making it noisier than the boys would like. But there you go. The first bird.
So he just went up like that through there, and his beak just went up as if he's getting the wind. Appears to me these little guys actually smell you.
Yep, Pākehā scent is alarming to many species, including some of our say whānau. And it's the biggest obstacle when stalking most wildlife. Animals have a natural fear of it, and for good reason too. This bird has obviously lost all sense of smell, is blind, and lost all reason. The boys have luck on their side this time. Unless, of course, their camera setup was wrong, eh?
Damn. Couldn't quite get a shot of him because this lens here is a 150 to 500. And he just came out of that bit of scrub there, and by the time he'd got out of it, where I could get a clear shot, he was out of focus. And he's not within my focal range.
That's a bit unfortunate. But out here, things don't always go the way you want them to. In fact, the weather's taking a turn for the worse, and like typical Rakiura, it's starting to bucket down. The boys are soft and weak, Pākehā. So they run back to the hut, cuddle up to the fire, and sip a warm cocoa for comfort. Back in my day, we didn't have no cocoa.
That's drawing well, isn't it, hey? You can listen to that, I like that sound.
Looks like the weather's showing signs of improvement. Wind's come up, so that'll shake a few of the drips off. But in the meantime, I'm gonna find a big tree and sit under it and do a bit of carving.
Steve's gone carving with polystyrene and some cloth. Paul's cooking up some weird ass kai, and Clyde's spending time looking for answers. They're mixed up a lot, these Pākehā fellas.
Get these caps on your lenses quickly. You don't want any dust or stuff to get into there.
The boys have spent a lot of time in the bush over the years, and as a result, often suffer from cabin fever. Four white boys dreaming of kiwi can lead to strange things, and strange carvings.
What the heck is that?
This kiwi's got bandier legs than Forrest Gump.
It's a complex egg system.
He's gotta go around.
Steve's not much of a carver, compared to the whānau, but I have to say it doesn't look too bad for a Pākehā's effort.
Something like that. Okay.
With a break in the weather, the boys grab the opportunity to go with the flow. Down the stream, of course. A few days ago, they marked a location on their GPS thing to save a lot of time and hassle finding the spot again.
We've decided to take a cruise down the river a bit, see what's going on down country a little way. But, trouble is, you see, I can't see where I'm going, so I'm relying on Clyde to direct me. The river's got an extraordinary flow to it.
You're left.
So we're going down quite fast, but there's a lot of vegetation on the sides. So sometimes the oar will hit a stick and we'll go a bit to one side. At least that's my excuse.
Oh, we're stuck.
Okay, now we'll need a bit of a push out. Quiet. This way. He's fast.
Two white boys trying to steer a boat. Oh, crack up.
We'll GPS the spot so we don't lose the boat because it's really flat and hard to find. And then we'll make it back here before dark. Is the plan. The water's going to be a lot lower. No, we're not at the right spot, it's further there. Because what I did is I marked the GPS point where we'd be best, closest to the bush, and it's just down at the next corner, so false alarm, we'll carry on.
Just a bit of advice for all you Pākehā folk out there, a page to check the GPS prior to trying to start a boat.
Well, not much is happening around here. Just sort of hanging around waiting for a kiwi to appear, but what we're going to do, that's that swampy stuff after we left the boat. Nothing in there, so the main bush is just up ahead here, so we're going to take a little peek around in there and see how we get on. Kiwi came running up to my feet there. He just shot back and ran along this log and ducked into that hole, and I can just have a peek in there. I just had a look and I can see there's at least two kiwi in there preening themselves, happily working for getting themselves some preparation for some invertebrate hunting tonight. Anyway, take a quick look and then we'll keep moving.
Invertebrate hunting tonight? Looks like this little guy's already found a trouser worm.
K
kiwi will nest in a variety of places, such as in old stumps, under logs, amongst the roots of trees, and even in clumps of tussock or crown fern. On a previous trip to Stewart Island, the boys were fortunate enough to see something that very few Pākehā have seen, a kiwi nest in the wild, which included a chick. They were making their way back to camp again because the rain was starting, and through the crown fern ahead, they heard little noises, and when they peered down to see what it was, this is what they saw. They couldn't believe their luck. After watching them for a couple of minutes, they backed away to leave them in peace. The chances of coming across a kiwi nest are so slim that it's almost inconceivable. But if you're one of those rare and lucky people who get to witness such a thing, it's very important not to disturb them in any way, or else they'll get pretty hoha. Coming up, a close encounter and extremely rare wild footage almost never seen in daylight.
We've got a better day today. The rain's sort of pulled away a little bit. It's extremely windy. We've got two types of terrain. We've got the low, swampy, scrubby sort of stuff. We're going to cut through that and we're going to head up into the forest and see how we get on.
It's the boys' third day and searching for kiwi on Rakiura. They've already seen some amazing stuff, but as can be expected, they still haven't got their ultimate shot. They're starting to get desperate, so they've decided to change their tactics. They're going plastic. It's time to put Egan, the polystyrene kiwi, to the test.
We were just coming up the track here, the track's right there. And we spotted a kiwi just feeding along the side there looking for grubs. Now earlier today we decided we'll bring Egan the kiwi here for a walk with us and plonk him down if we saw a kiwi, and we decided we'll just, for observation, see what happens if they spot another kiwi. And anyway, we pegged him in the ground here, and blow me down if the kiwi wasn't mooching around here. As soon as he spotted it, he just came trotting over. Now, obviously he must have seen me or heard the click of the camera, because I just managed to snap off a couple of shots and off he went. But totally amazing. Yeah, great observation. Egan the kiwi.
To see kiwi as close range in their natural habitat, just doing their thing without any hassles, is impressive stuff, alright? When you consider that probably 99.99% of Pākehā have never seen one in the wild, it makes you realise how fortunate these fellows are to experience this. Southern tokoeka can be found from the coast right up to the mountain shrublands. You'll see them feeding during daylight hours, even up to the altitudes of 650 metres above sea level. Looks like he's too close to the boys, or he's got a bug stuck up his nose. This bird has a band around its leg. The Department of Conservation has banded 100 birds on the island. This is the second one boys have encountered. I like the kiwi. It's funny and feisty. Of all the native birds, the kiwi is the special one. Maori used to use their soft feathers and cloaks for chiefs. We also used to hunt them for food, but we don't do that anymore, eh? Tokoeka can live for over 40 years, and on Rakiura, both the male and the female are raised tamariki. A real whānau affair.
Busy little guys, aren't they? It's quite late now. Beautiful forest, isn't it? Anyway, we'll see if we can follow this little guy. You've got to keep your distance with these little suckers, but if you're careful, they'll run right past you. As they're hunting around. I've really got no good shot, so what I've got to do is I'm going to drop my exposure level down so I'm shooting underexposed by at least a stop. Change ISO to 1600. And shoot on AV, and then open it to the widest aperture. That gives those all the little tricks you can get to increase your light in the bush and dark situations like this.
It's the last afternoon of the trip and it's getting late. Although they've seen some cool stuff, much more than any park here would normally see. There's still a chance to get that awesome calendar shot, so they're giving it one last try.
Just heard a kiwi call, somewhere straight in front of us. It's about 5:05 in the afternoon, so I'm going to sneak in through here and then just sort of take a little posse and just sit for a while and see if we can pick up movement or sound.
As these guys know, you've got to take your time and be patient. You never know when a kiwi's going to creep up on you. A male kiwi has to have a territory before he can attract the mate. That territory might be anything from 5 to 50 hectares, depending on the food that's there. That means he can't be a lazy dude. He can't stay home with his feet up. He has to patrol it looking for intruders. That's good news for us. This kiwi's trying to stay still while he works out if we're a threat or not. The boys are doing the same. We're a lot bigger than him, but kiwis have very solid legs and can let out a powerful kick when necessary to ward off predators or intruders. Just like my auntie Mona. They've always got sharp spurs on their feet, so they're not a walkover in a scrap. During a fight, one good blow can send an opposing kiwi several feet in the air. Yep, just like my Auntie Monet. If there's one thing that we've learned over the years, it's that persistence works. You have to hang on right up to the last minute if you want that outstanding shot. That's Rakura for you. It never fails to impress. The boys got the shots they came for and more, which was a big surprise to them and me. Next week, the dudes head to Fiordland in search of the mighty roaring red stags. He kona rā whānau.
Oh! Oh!